This tutorial is going to take you through some basic tips and tricks for PowerPoint and Microsoft Word. So in Word, we're going to look at headers and footers, spacing and paragraph styles, footnotes, page breaks, and then just some tips on clicking around. I realize this might seem basic, but honestly, a lot of people do it incorrectly or cost themselves a lot more time than they should. So the second thing we're going to look at is PowerPoint. And we're going to look at shapes, color, and transparency, backgrounds, animations, transitions, smart art, and then logos and graphics. I realize that, again, seems basic, and it's a lot of information, but we're just going to look at some really simple things to hopefully make things easier for you. So the first thing we're going to look at here is the Microsoft Word bit. And so this is what it normally looks like when you're in Microsoft Word. This is the page layout view. And there's one way to make this much easier to read. I find it really difficult or really annoying to have to scan through and have these big breaks, especially when there are headers and footers, because it's kind of distracting. So what you do is only at the top here, when you see this little up and down arrow, you can see it gives me this double click to hide white space. So if you double click, it actually removes your headers and footers and creates one nice long block of text. So that's really, really useful. But of course, it means that you also can't access your headers and footers. So when we're going to work with those, you have to open up this white space. So to get to your headers and footers, it's actually really simple. You just go into the header area and double click, and you can see it opens my header and it opens my footer. So here you can do all sorts of things. You can change your style here. You can change to make sure that it's a different first page or different odd and even pages, all of that sort of stuff, right? So in this case, I'm going to type in my last name and let's say paper one or something like that, right? And then let's say I want to go to other area, the right side of my document. I can just double click here to open that up, and then I'm going to insert my page number, and then I can go to the top of the page, and then on the right, and there we go. Okay. Oh, except that removed my header, which is not useful. Okay. So it's going to write justify it, which is really irritating, but that's okay. You can always just tab. Once I type that in, just tab to move it over to the left here. Once moves it to the center, twice moves it over to the left. So now I've got my my header, and I can always add a footer here, whatever I wanted. In this case, I'm not going to use footers, but notice that it automatically appeared on my second piece, and to get out of this, all I do is double click outside. But you can see that it's kind of distracting when I'm going from piece to piece. Again, when you have a title page and an abstract page, you usually do not want the header there. Certainly on the title page, you don't want the title. I'm sorry, you don't want your header and you don't want a page number, so you would click on different first page. Often you would just have a separate document that would have your title page, and then the abstract page would have the different first page piece on it. Okay. So that's my header and my footer, and I'm going to talk a little bit about spacing and paragraph styles. This is the default for Microsoft Word, and I find this to be really irritating, actually. So I'm going to double click on this. So you can see, to really click with Microsoft Word, one click changes location, two clicks selects a word, three clicks selects the entire paragraph. So that makes things a lot easier. So in this, I'm going to triple click here to get my whole paragraph. I'm going to right click and go to paragraph. And you can see that it's done a few things here. When I pasted this lorem ipsum text in, it justified it, which is not what I want. I would always want this to be left justified. And it made some weird line spacing here. So I'm actually going to make this a 0 point before and after, and I'm going to make this double spaced, which is what you would normally have for a document, unless you're doing a block quote, in which case it would be single spaced. So I'm gonna click on OK, and this is what I want most of my text to look like. Now, that's a pain in the butt to do all over, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna highlight this, and then I'm gonna click on my Format Painter here. Once that's done, I can actually highlight another area of text, and it will automatically make that the right format. Didn't work the first time, but it worked the second time. So there you go. Okay. So this looks a lot more like a document that I would want to use. I can press tab to go ahead and indent here. If I want to make this into a block quote, the second piece here, I can simply remove my tab. I'm going to triple click, and then I'm going to indent this with this button up here, and then I'm going to single space it. So here we have our block quote. Now notice that this makes this piece look a little weird. So what I always do is I add an extra return in between if I have a, so when I have a block quote and then I move on to my next line. Even if this wasn't another paragraph, it would look strange. As you can see, if I didn't have that, it would look like this, which is not what you want. You want an extra line in there, right? Okay. So now let's talk about footnotes. So let's say I had you use footnotes for your citation styles, or more commonly, I might actually have you do an explanation for a piece. So let's say I wanted to provide a translation for this. Well, I don't know what that says because I don't speak Latin, but let's say I did. So I'm gonna click right outside here, outside the period, and then I'm going to go into, press Alt-I, and then NN is going to give me notes, right? So that's one way to do it. You can also just go to insert, and then you can go to your, I'm sorry, it's not an insert. It's in references in Microsoft Word in 2013. So here I can go and I can add a footnote in here. Now notice again, like I talked about in another tutorial, you don't want to use this citation style generator. You want to make, I mean, you can go ahead and use it if you want to, and this can actually keep all of your sources together, and that's fantastic. The problem is that this is not going to look the way that you want it to look. It's not going to look it's not going to be the right citation style. So you want to edit it when you're done. So I'm going to insert a footnote, and you can see that this, and then I can go ahead and I can type my footnote here, right? So you can see that this automatically created a footnote, right? And that it put it at the end of my document automatically. So you don't want to put this in manually. It has to be automatic. Now, one of the issues with footnotes is that they are a little strange. That this actually, it says it's a footnote, but it's not a footnote. It's an endnote, which means it's at the end of the document. So I'm going to triple click to highlight the whole thing. Then I'm going to right click on it. Oops. And I'm going to go to convert to footnote. So what that does, it puts it, so here's my piece here, and it's going to put it at the bottom of the page, not at the bottom of the document. So that's what I'm looking for. Okay, so the last thing is something that people often don't realize that they can do. Let's say this top bit was my abstract. What people often do is they press enter, and they keep pressing enter until this moves to the next page. Now, you never want to do that. I am going to actually insert a page break here. So I'm going to press enter. Well, actually, you can just, I'm going to delete that. You can just start at the beginning of this paragraph. And then I'm going to go to insert and then page break. And what that does is it automatically changes the page here. So I can keep typing, I can keep changing my abstract, and that's not actually going to change that this is on a different page. So it's a really, really useful way of quickly navigating through a document. One of the other things I wanted to mention, though, is that you do not want to use this cover page piece in Microsoft Word. It might look really good, but the reason that you don't want to do this is that it doesn't allow people to put in comments and edit these sections using track changes. So you never want to use one of these cover pages. Just go ahead and do a very simple the title of the document, the class number, all of that kind of stuff in there. Okay. So let's look at PowerPoint now. So here are some simple things that I would suggest doing in PowerPoint. So when you open PowerPoint, this is again, if you choose a blank template, this is what you're going to get. And there's a bunch of things that you can do to make this look a lot better. There's a tutorial that I've got on editing master slides, and that gives you a little bit more information. But For now, I'm going to just show you how to make one single piece look really good. So I'm going to go to my insert, and I'm going to start designing or adding in shapes. So I'm going to choose some, let's choose some triangles here. And I'm going to zoom out at the bottom of the screen here, so I have a little bit of space, and I'm going to create some triangles. Okay, so I've got this one triangle here, and let's say I want to make another triangle. Next to it, and then another triangle next to that. So that doesn't look all that great, obviously, right? But you can see up here, we actually have the beginnings of a design. So there's a bunch of things that I can do to change this. When I go into my shape fill, I can choose some different colors. And this is going to automatically give me kind of brand congruent or colors that match, right? So I can choose colors that work well together. And it allows me my fill, which is on the inside, and it allows me to do my shape outline, which is I'm going to make no outline on all of these. Okay, you can also choose your specific colors by going to the eyedropper, which means that let's say I wanted this shape here to be the same color as this shape, I could go to my eyedropper and then select it, and it will automatically change the outline there. But that's obviously not what I want to do here, but that's very useful if you've got a logo and you want to make it look brand congruent. That's one of the best ways to do it. So okay, I've got my my piece here, and so I want to actually mess with these shapes a little bit. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to my fill here, and then I'm going to go to gradient and then more gradients. And the reason I'm doing this is that it actually brings up the format shape dialog box. That's one of the easiest ways to do it. Right now there's a solid fill. I could make that a gradient fill very easily by clicking on gradient, and then I can change my colors here. So let's say I wanted this to be a little bit of a different color here. I could do that. Let's say I wanted it to be a little bit more, you know, just a little bit more creative. Can make all sorts of different colors here. And so that gives you some idea of what you can do. Okay, so that, again, you know, doesn't look great. That's not really what I'm looking for. So I'm gonna go back to my solid fill. And I'm going to change that back to whatever color that was. Let's say that color. Okay, but what you can do is you can actually change your transparency down. So I can actually create a much more interesting effect by reducing the transparency of all of these pieces. And you'll notice that in the stock templates that Microsoft gives you, so if we go into design and then you take a look at this one, for instance, that's basically what they've done. They've created all of these different triangles and they've overlaid them on top of one another at different levels of transparency. So this is one way of making a custom deck that can actually be really beautiful. And you can see if I go to viewing the slideshow, it's actually not a bad deck. It looks pretty good. And you would often put that on the right, but maybe you would have your logo on your right, and this is just a way to pull away from it. That could be maybe, I don't know, a ski resort or something like that. But there's all sorts of ways to do that with just very, very simple shapes, and there's many, many different kinds of shapes. Now, when you're working with shapes, and you often will, you often have things that are just like boxes and things like that you want to have copy inside, right? So let's say you would want to have a box here. That, again, I'm going to take off that outline, or let's put an outline on there just to give you a sense of what you would do with that outline. So let's say you wanted it to look like this, and you want to have a little bit of a title here. So let's insert some copy, and I'm going to put, I don't know, just to stick with that alpine ski resort sort of feel to it. I'm gonna make this a little bigger. And you'll notice when you drag these around that there's that little dashed red line, and that actually shows you the center of my copy is the same as the center of this shape. And it will do that in all sorts of different ways. So you can actually align it to the edge of my shape there. You can align it to the center of that shape. So there's all sorts of ways of aligning. So really use that line. It's incredibly useful. Okay, so we've got this Alpine Ski Resort thing. Now let's go ahead and if we want to stay brand congruent, we can change our color here. So we can go to Format, and we can go to our Text Fill, Eyedropper, and let's choose this dark blue. So you can see that I'm already getting a deck that looks pretty good. So now let's go to create some more text here. And maybe I'll make a box here instead of just clicking on it. I'll make a box. And I'll just make something up. Alpine Ski Resort was founded in 2014 by, I don't know, someone. Okay. And then maybe let's put in some bullets or let's say Alpine Ski Resort is the most famous, or is the famous resort in Colorado. So let's put in some bullets here to make this look a little bit better. And I'm going to click on my bullets piece here. So it was founded in 2014. Or let's say 1914. Features, I don't know, log cabins, whatever you want to say here, right? So we can go ahead and highlight all of this. Again, we can make it brand congruent really easily by making it white or making it a light blue or something like that. You can also change your transparency. So features, log cabins. If I press tab here, log cabins are great, etc., etc. Okay, so here we've got multiple bullets. To inset a bullet, you just press tab. So I can make another bullet there. And now if I want to go back, I can hold down shift and press tab. Right, okay. So that gives you some really useful pieces. And again, we see that this actually looks pretty good. Notice that it cuts off the edges of those shapes. So I can drag a shape off the edge of the screen, like here. I don't have that the rectangle ending at the edge here because I want this to look like it's coming off the screen, so that the stroke here, the edge, the outline, is only on these pieces and not on this edge, right? Okay. So here we've got our slide. This doesn't look so bad. So let's go from here to something else. Maybe let's actually bring in an image would be a ski resort image. So I'm going to make a new slide here, and I could just copy and paste all of these if I didn't have a master deck set up, right? So that would give me those pieces. But what I want to do here is actually add a full image. So I'm just going to delete all of this. I'm going to hold down shift to grab all of these and delete them. One quick trick for images or for shapes is that when you're resizing, notice that it stretches it out when I'm resizing. So I'm going to make this a little darker so that you can see it. So it stretches it out, right? If I don't want to do that, I can press shift, hold down shift as I'm dragging it, and that's going to keep it the exact same proportions. If I hold down shift and control, it's going to do it from the same spot. Right? So this is where it started. And here I can see that it's growing in the same spot and proportionally by holding down shift and control. Okay. So if I wanted to have an image here of mountains, then I could do that pretty easily. And now I'm going to import that image through, if I can find it. So I just clicked and dragged to bring that in. So So you can see it's way too small. And you normally wouldn't want to use a small image, but I think in this case it's okay just because you don't want it to be pixelated. So I'm going to click and drag, and you can see that it's going to look okay here, but it's going to be a little pixelated. So normally I probably wouldn't use this image, but that's okay. For this, it's okay. So you can see if I wanted to put any copy on top of this, it would be almost impossible to see. So what you do is you actually change this. Instead of actually adding this image in itself, what you do is you add in a shape. So I'm going to add in, and this is only for Microsoft's Office for a PC. On a Mac, you can just change the transparency directly, but on a PC, you have to actually do it manually. Through a shape. So normally you would put that image in on a Mac, you would just change the transparency. On a PC, you go to Picture Fill, and I'm gonna grab my file from my desktop, and you can see it puts in that picture, and then I can change the transparency. So I can actually have a really, really subtle piece here if I wanted to. And then I could, of course, put my copy on top of this. So I'm gonna grab this, grab all of this, Control C to copy it, and then Control V to paste it in. So you can see that that actually adds a little bit of flavor to the document, right? To the PowerPoint. Okay. So you know, not always necessary, but it could look really good, especially if you're doing a poster or something. But to make it really brand congruent, that's one of the best things that you can do. Okay, so right now, let's actually change this to history, and then I'll change these to something else. Okay. I'm just throwing some stuff up there so you can see a difference between one slide and the other slide. Okay. So when you're actually doing a PowerPoint, we're going to look at animations and transitions here. This looks okay, but it's a little sharp for me, and I would recommend not doing it. So what I'd recommend doing is a transition. So what you do is you click on transitions, and I would always use the same transition. Never use multiple transitions throughout your presentation. I'm going to just I'm going to click and then hold down shift and click again to grab both of these. And I'm going to click on fade. So you can see now, when we watch the piece, that it fades from one to the other, right? A really nice way to do it. Okay. Now that we've got this, I want to make this look a little better, which is to not have all of the stuff pop up at once. So I'm going to highlight all of these pieces, and I'm going to go to animations, and I'm going to have fade on these as well. So what's happened is that it's going to fade all of these pieces in at once. Now, if I want to move this, so right now when we look at it, when I click, it's going to bring all of that up. What I want to do instead is have these pieces come up individually. So I'm going to have this come up on click or after previous. So in this case, I'm going to do on click. In this, I'm going to do on click. And notice that it's changing the numbers here. And this one will be on click. So right now, what's going to happen is I'm going to click once, click twice, click three times, click four times, and then it changes. Okay. But let's actually change that a little bit more. Let's have my sub-bullets come in after previous. So that means that once I click on this features log cabins thing, these are going to come in automatically. So click once, click twice, click three times, and then those come up automatically, and then four times. So it's just a way to bring some life to your document without actually having you click all the time. It's a really nice way of just having things flow. Okay, so let's make another slide here. And I want to talk a little bit about smart art. And smart art can be great, and it can be really bad. So you just have to be very careful. You just click on your smart art thing in insert, and you can choose all sorts of different pieces here. In communications, we use this stuff a lot, and business uses it a lot. It might be a list, it might be a hierarchy, something like that, a relationship, a cycle, something like that. And when you're doing this, it's fine. You know, you can just grab these pieces, and it will insert it in, and you can change all of your colors and everything as you choose to. And then you just type in your text. So you can do it from here directly, or you can do it here. And you can always add new pieces, again, the same way. Enter is gonna add a new block. If I hold down Shift and Tab, it's gonna create another piece. Actually, this one is not gonna be quite what we're looking for. So let's do it this way. So now we've got three. Now we've got two. Make a third. Make a fourth. So actually, this is gonna only do two. This is why smart art is often a problem, because it doesn't necessarily do what you want it to do. But anyway, it's a cool way to play with the document and to actually make some really interesting relationships, make some really interesting captions, all of that kind of stuff. So it's something to play with in your presentations when you're trying to show relationships or trying to show some kind of content that needs an infographic. So the last thing we're going to do is look at logos and graphics. So I'm going to make a new slide. And you would normally use a logo for your organization in the bottom right-hand corner of the screen. If you remember the PowerPoint that I brought up, the Rollins logo is in the bottom right-hand corner, and it's kind of transparent. So that's what you would normally do. I'm just going to, let's say, I'll grab a Facebook logo or something like that. Okay, so if I'm in my images, I'm gonna go to search tools, and I wanna have something that's large, and that's pretty important. Okay, so here, I'm gonna grab this one here, and you can see that it looks okay. The problem is that it has a white background around it. Not all of them do, but it does, and so I'm gonna grab, actually, I think I'm gonna grab this one also, that's Twitter. Well, no, I'll grab this. Okay, so I've got my image. Oh, that's transparent, so that's not exactly what I want to do. You can see that it's checkered up here and then white down here, and I want to show you something that's different. So here we go. It's white all the way around. So I'm going to save my image. And then I'm going to open that up in here, but first, I'm going to choose this same background. Okay. And then I'm going to grab that image. So I'm going to draw a shape first again. So insert, shape. It'll be about there. And then I'm going to do a picture fill, file. Grab the Facebook logo. You can see that it's not quite the way we want it to be. There we go. Okay, so I'm gonna remove that transparency. And you can see that this is kind of a problem. Well, one, because I've got this this blue line around it, so I'm gonna take that off. But two, because there's this white background. So I'm gonna go into this, and I'm gonna go into my picture tools format, and I'm gonna go to remove background. And when you're here, you can mark areas to keep and areas to remove. So first I'm gonna grab areas to keep, which is I really wanna keep, I'm just gonna click and drag, which creates a line rather than click on the lots of little pieces. For some reason, it really, 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 really doesn't wanna keep all of this white. But eventually you'll grab it. Okay. So all of that's there, and it looks like it's done a really good job of taking out all of that. If it hadn't taken out that white, you would go to mark areas of remove, and again, you would draw a line down the center of all of those pieces until it actually grabbed out all of that white. So you click on keep changes, and you can see the logos there. Although you can see that it's actually taken out a small chunk of this. So you would again go back into remove background, mark areas to keep, and you'd want to drag that out. It looks like that might have done it. Just making this a little bit larger. But you could just mark that to keep, of course, as well. Okay. So once we're here, you can see how much of a difference this makes. And normally, again, I would actually make this transparent. So I would actually drag this to maybe 50% transparency. But you can see how much of a difference this makes to the document. And if you did this in the master template, then you'd have this little logo at the bottom right-hand corner of all of your different slides, which could look really, really nice. Okay, so I think that's about everything that you need to know for PowerPoint to get started. But remember that this is like creating a magazine. You should look at your PowerPoint decks in the way that you would create a magazine or something like that, where layout is really important, the color is really important. Really try to make it look good and be creative with it. Good luck.